You're listening to the audio production of Blind Ambition, How to Go from Victim to Visionary, by Chad E. Foster, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by Zach Hoffman. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperfocusaudio.com.
To Evie, for everything. I mean everything. The love, the sacrifices, and support. To Juliana, for your open heart, genuine personality, and relentless effort. To Jackson, for your fearless spirit, caring soul, and unwavering determination. To Mom, who showed me the meaning of true love, selflessness. To Dad, who taught me how to be tough enough and never settle for less. Prologue. Blind Ambition. How to Go from Victim to Visionary. The black SUV rolled through the hills of Northern Virginia as I sat in the back seat, headed to my big job interview. I'd been fielding calls from Ben, my interviewer, for many months about possibly coming to work for his company, SRA International. In recent years, while working for another big tech company, I developed a special niche in business analytics, becoming an expert in the arcane field of financial modeling and pricing strategies. Now it was time for me to make a move, and I felt sure I could be of help to SRA. The SUV glided to a stop in front of SRA's offices, and I stepped out into the warm August sunshine. I grabbed my black leather briefcase, made my way to the rear of the vehicle, and popped open the liftgate. Romeo, my 115-pound German Shepherd guide dog, was waiting patiently for me, furiously wagging his tail. I collected his leash and called him out of the vehicle. Once he was standing at attention by my left side, I gave him the door command, and he led us to the building entrance. Romeo was an imposing figure, with a velvety black and tan coat and a head the size of a basketball. He was both adorable and intimidating. Romeo and I were fast walkers, and from afar, you might not think I was Romeo's blind handler. With me in a business suit and dark sunglasses, the two of us appeared more like a plainclothes police officer walking a canine service dog. Once inside SRA's headquarters, Ben introduced me around to other people on his team. Then we returned to his office, where Romeo led me to a chair. Once I sat down, Romeo could relax because his work was done for the moment. He remained perfectly quiet and motionless for the duration of the meeting, like any well-trained guide dog. In our prior conversations, Ben and I had discovered that we spoke a common language regarding how large-scale technology services should be priced and how the financials of those deals could be best managed. Now, for the first time, I was able to open up my laptop on his desk and show him some of the computer models I'd developed to inform my insights. I could tell by the sound of Ben's voice that he was impressed. For the next several minutes, Ben explained how the role he had in mind for me required much more than mere technical expertise. I would not only have to analyze vast amounts of data to arrive at my recommended pricing guidance, I'd also have to convince the company's executives that my strategy was the winning and profitable approach. "These are multi-billion dollar deals, you understand," Ben said. "Some of them can make or break the company." Ben paused. In a tone that reflected his natural curiosity, he asked, "Chad, can you really do all these things?" I took only a split second to reply. "Ben," I said, "this stuff is so easy, I can do it with my eyes closed." I still remember the sound of Ben bursting into laughter. He hired me later that month, mainly because he knew I could do the job, but also because he knew I was comfortable enough in my own skin to joke about being blind. I had the business and tech skills to succeed, but just as important, he saw firsthand how I could handle myself in a meeting with self-confidence and good humor. I've learned to find humor in being blind because I can't change how blindness is such a big part of my life. Wherever I go, I'm led by a German Shepherd guide dog. It is not easy to hide a large German Shepherd in a conference room. So, because it's nearly impossible for me to pretend to be someone I'm not, I decided many years ago to accept who I am and deal with my everyday reality head on, embracing it, owning it, and yes, even welcoming it. It won't help me or anyone else if I'm ashamed or apologetic about being blind, or if I fail to express myself fully because of it. This self-awareness was forced upon me by my blindness, but it has made me a better person today than I was before I lost my eyesight. I am a better person because of my blindness, not in spite of it. As someone who could see until young adulthood, I know how tempting it is for many of us to put up a false front and avoid the responsibility of sincere self-acceptance and authentic self-expression. My blindness disallows the charades and pretensions I once hid behind. I have learned in the years since losing my eyesight to live according to my own standards and on my terms. For those of you not as fortunate, this is my story. Chapter 1. The Final Sunset. This can't be happening. The brightly lit pages of the textbook on my desk had just dissolved into a muddled mass of colors. My eyes were no longer working. In the course of several minutes, what looked like a dense swarm of bees had overtaken my field of vision. "Not this. Not now," I muttered to myself with frustration. How would I explain why I hadn't completed my assignment? It was a cool East Tennessee evening in the fall of 1996, just a few months shy of my 21st birthday, when I realized I would soon permanently lose my ability to see. The trees on my college campus that afternoon were awash in fall foliage, deep crimson red, brilliant pumpkin orange, and sawdust shades of yellow brown. Outside the suburban Knoxville home I'd been raised in, the yard was filled with brightly colored fallen leaves. But in my second floor bedroom, my life was taking a much darker turn. I was hovering over my desk with a blazing bright lamp beaming down on my college literature assignment as I tried to blink away the swarms of floaters obscuring the words on the page. Floaters. Those dark little specks that most people experience as fleeting shadows in their field of vision had been an increasing problem for me of late. I was having more and more bad days with them, a common symptom of my eye condition, retinitis pigmentosa. Without warning, the floaters would start piling up before me like swarming bees. I'd have to stop what I was doing and roll my eyes to make the floaters clear out, just to get a few moments of visual clarity. But until this moment, the floaters had never prevented me from getting my schoolwork done. What should have been a 30-minute reading assignment was taking me more than 2 hours, and I still wasn't finished. Feelings of frustration welled up inside me. No matter how frequently I rolled my eyes and rubbed them, all I could see was a teeming mosh pit of floaters. The textbook in front of me dissolved into a sea of black and white bubbles. I grew increasingly impatient and tried every trick to work around the problem. Now, nothing I tried was of help. No matter how close I looked or how much I tried to brighten the page, I could not make out any of the words. Finally, giving in to my frustration, I wadded up my notes into a ball and threw it against the wall. Enraged, I shoved my books off my desk and onto the floor and screamed, "Damn it!" When my rage was finally exhausted, I sat there trembling, with a cold feeling of sadness that dripped down into the deepest crevices of my soul. Weighed down by the enormous gravity of my new reality, it was hard to move, hard to breathe. "This is it," I said to myself. This was what the doctors predicted. The blindness that had been closing in on me slowly since I was a small child had arrived. I was struck with the disturbing realization that very soon I would be reading my last page of print. I'd see my last smiling face. I'd scribble my last note. I'd watch my final football game. I'd enjoy my final sunset. All the gifts that vision grants us would soon be lost to me forever. I looked around the room and could barely make out the details of my wall decorations. I mostly saw only hazy regions of light and dark, blurred by the tears that were filling my eyes. Life, as I'd known it, was coming to an end. I was completely unprepared for what would come next. Magical thinking. We were warned this day could arrive nearly 20 years earlier. My parents noticed how their 3-year-old toddler kept bumping into things, especially in dimly lit rooms. They took me to eye specialists at Duke University Medical Center, and it didn't take long for them to diagnose me with retinitis pigmentosa. RP, as it's called, is the medical term for a group of rare genetic disorders that cause a gradual and irreversible breakdown of the photoreceptor cells in the retina. Globally, it affects about 1 in every 4,000 people. Early symptoms of RP typically include difficulty seeing at night and a loss of side vision or peripheral vision. At the age of 3, I had both of these symptoms. The doctors told us that I could go blind eventually, possibly at an early age, although some people with RP don't lose their eyesight until middle age or later, and a lucky few retain minimally functioning eyesight their entire lives. We were cautioned that there was no real cure for RP and no effective means of treating it or slowing its progression. My parents cried the entire drive home. It's hard to imagine what it must have been like to hear the news about their 3-year-old child. The doctor hadn't given them much hope to hang on to. "Try to prepare for the day when Chad's vision is gone," he'd said. "In the meantime, enjoy life while you can." For the next 17 years, I followed only the second half of the doctor's advice. I enjoyed my life, but I never spent a minute preparing to be blind. I grew up in a modest single-family home with my parents and my older brother, Eric, in the suburban Knoxville town of Halls. My father, Charles, was a hard-working car salesman who could sell ice in Antarctica. My mother, Peggy, worked as a bookkeeper most of her life and brought that spirit of care and buttoned-up organization to our everyday lives. Everyone on both sides of my family had great eyesight, with no history of RP symptoms. Doctors later discovered that my parents each happened to be carriers of a hidden or recessive gene for RP. That meant there was only a 1 in 4 chance that their offspring would get RP. I was the unlucky winner of that lottery. And yet, I behaved like any other adventurous little kid. I was full of energy and determined to run and play as hard as my older brother, my cousins, and all my friends. Bumps and bruises became a way of life for me. My limited peripheral vision meant I often failed to see obstacles at my feet, so I tripped and fell down a lot. Sometimes the consequences were much worse than bumps and bruises. At age 3, I broke my leg at my grandparents' house when I jumped out of the bed of our parked pickup truck. I still remember landing squarely on the gravel driveway as my left femur snapped like a twig. A shockwave of pain coursed through my body, and I could see the horrified look on my parents' faces as they came running. I was in a body cast for the next 3 months, and one of my earliest and most vivid memories was the terror I felt when doctors used power tools to remove the cast. I felt certain they were going to saw off my leg. Undeterred, once the cast was gone, I started running around and playing at full speed. A couple years later at my other grandparents' farm, I ran headlong into a steel pipe that I failed to see in the dimming light of dusk. The warm blood ran down my face and into my eyes as my parents carried me to the car. I remember the scent of the blood-soaked towel covering my head, and that the blood left a metallic taste in my mouth as we headed to the hospital emergency room. I was back in that same ER less than 2 months later. This time, after...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.